My parents' name is Louise Manigo White, and my father is Abraham White. He was born in Charleston, South Carolina. Yeah. I have four sisters, two brothers. One is deceased, and my sisters are Janet White, Alisa Smalls, Mary Graddick, and me. And my brother is Abraham White and Calvin Manico, deceased. When somebody talk about Gullah or Geechee, is really the language that we speak, and we speak the language from our ancestors from Africa, and it carries on a dialect from now into up to now. Some people try to disguise it, but all the time that sometime down the line, you are going to portray the Geechee language somewhere down the line, but I doesn't disguise how I speak and how to put on the proper language and all that. I just speak the way I supposed to, because a lot of people tell me that, you know, I really love your accent. You sound like you are from Jamaica. But I went on a cruise to Jamaica and I did not born in Jamaica. But, you know, our language just is just that, Gullah or Geechee. Some people talk that way, but I just do how I was taught. My grandparents talked that way, and we went to school. You get schooling, but you still got the Gullah or Geechee language. I got a lot of. Okay, when I was growing up, the tradition, we cooked on wood stove. We have outhouses, and we did all the farming and harvesting our food. We go and get, like, we had to go and cut wood and bring it back to heat and to cook on. When I was growing up, I learned how to cook on wood stove. My sisters and brothers, they didn't actually get to do it like how I did it, but the tradition is that we cook on wood stove, and then when we do the baskets, my grandmama and her friends would come over and sit down under the tree, and they sew a basket all day, and they go from house to house. If somebody come today, they say, well, I going to so-and-so house tomorrow. then we'll stay. Then we'll stay at the house. We cannot leave the yard or go anywhere to play, and then until they come back. But the trick we didn't used to get us is that when we start sewing basket, they give everybody a certain size, a basket to sew. And when we sew, we got to do like 3 or 4 of them. They know exactly how you fast you sew and what you can do. But you cannot leave until that happened. But they didn't know exactly when, how much time that they're going to have, so when they can come back from work, we'll still be there. So if you do not finish your basket or finish your piece of well, okay, y'all did good, y'all can go play. That is just to keep us in the yard and don't get in no trouble. So that's where the tradition is, to keeping out us at the house. And then when the boys them got to either rake the yard or cut wood or clean up the whole pen or whatever, just to keep them there. But they still know how to sew basket too. All our family know how to sew, boys and girls. Yeah, but that's mostly the thing. And then we used to go in the bean field and make money. And then in the summertime, especially in summertime, we go and work in the field and make our school money to buy our clothes. And then we go to town. And then the older kids have to watch out for the younger kids so they can help them shop. But if they come back and they don't do what they're supposed to do, they in trouble. They in trouble. But otherwise, that's most a lot of tradition. Because I grew up under older people, so I learned a bunch of old tradition things. They learn us how to cook, how to wash. We used to wash clothes on the washboard. And we used to wash clothes on, and the clothes used to be so white. We used to get hot water. We used to get the hot water and boil it in a separate tub, and used to put the white clothes in there, take it out and hang it out, and that clothes looked like white as snow. And we put it on the line, and like when they bring the clothes in, then we have to iron, they starch it. They used to use liquid starch, and then they roll it, and then they put it in the refrigerator. And they put it in the refrigerator, and then when you wanna iron it, then they take it out the refrigerator so that when the starch and the clothes still be moist. And then when you iron it, it come to nice crisp, just like going to the laundry. And what else we used to do? Oh God. Back then, we don't, like when company come, you can't sit, like how these young kids come and sit in the company. Oh no, you can't do that. You got to go outside. And then sometimes when they be outside, you be outside all day. Cause you can't go in the house. You got to stay outside on the porch until so-and-so. And if they be talking, and you just walk up and interrupt their conversation, no, that's a slap in the mouth. You be like, pow! Can't you see grown people talking? Then you can't say nothing. You just gotta turn around and go back outside. But if you come in and say, excuse me, and say, mama, can I do so-and-so? Then they'll listen to you. But you don't correct. No, they don't come in and interrupt nobody. And then like we do chores and stuff, you do a lot of, get your chores done. And on Fridays, we do all of that for one bag of peanut. And you'd be so happy for that bag of peanut because that's a treat that they're looking for on Friday. When my granddaddy come from the grocery store, he have a bag of peanut for everybody who does their work. But thing about it, he have the one for one who ain't done the work. He let them suffer for a little while, and then he say, hey, next time you do your work and then you will get your peanut. Yeah, but that's how we used to enjoy getting one bag of peanut. And be now these kids here, if you don't give them nothing, they ain't gonna do nothing. My dad used to work he started out, he been driving trucks for a gas company. Then after that, he started work for Charleston County School, and he worked in the maintenance department until he retired.
So did your mom work as well?
My mom did housekeeping, and he worked for one particular lady for years until she retired. She raised one girl. They had one girl, and she raised their daughter. And she still be behind us. Like, you know, if something happened, she'd be right there as a part of the family. All we have to do is call her, and she do whatever she can do. But my mom just take care of us and does that kind of work. Yeah. My mom really taught us how to survive, because when we didn't have anything, or we have to provide, she had to provide for us. He always give us some type of memory or whatever to say, just remember what this is. And always save a penny for a rainy day or something like that, or make sure your kids have something to eat, something to wear, and it doesn't have to be like new stuff. As long as you survive, your children have that. My mama used to always say, if you eat, your child will eat. Because my mama used to always say, you eat, your children eat first, and you eat later. So that's how me and my sister them learned how to do things and how to work and get things for us. We don't ever learn how to depend on people. If we try to make sure if we can do it, then we ask for it. But right now to the day, my sister and brother, like if one fall, all try to pick them up. And we always, my mama used to always say, when one of y'all fall, one of y'all gonna pick them up. If one don't pick them up, everybody can pick up. Because when you need, the other one need. So we've been doing that. My mama died in December of Hugo, and we always do. We've been being together for that time up to now. We always have Thanksgiving dinner, and we've been doing that before she died, and we still do it every Thanksgiving. The only time we didn't have a Thanksgiving dinner is when my brother got sick and he couldn't do it. But when he died, we had the Thanksgiving dinner at his house because he wanted us to be together, but he couldn't get there, so we went there and have the dinner at his. And that's a tradition. We have been doing it for 27 years, and we never stopped. My grand aunt inspired me by helping me do these baskets. She learned. My grandmama taught me how to make baskets. We used to just make the flat part. But my first aunt, one of my aunt, I used to always stay with her, and she taught me how to turn the basket up and make styles. And my other aunt, she did the same thing and helped me to make different styles and shape. And that gave me the inspiration to keep on sewing. Sometime when the other one be running around and playing or whatever, I'm always being the one sitting on the porch and making baskets. And to this day, I think I'm the only one that actually sew a basket and keep the basket going for my family, because a lot of them just dropped off and doesn't do it anymore. But I think it's me, I think three of us actually sew basket and have like basket stand and go around and do other things. But I think I'm the more popular one to go from state to state and do things. They always say, well, how you do this, how you do that? I said, well, you got to love something to always do something, because if I didn't love doing it, I wouldn't have keep it up. And a lot of people inspire me to keep the basket going, encourage me to go different places and spread the word about the basket. I have traveled so many different places and did so many things with the basket, and they helped me trying to get my supply and all that. But I joined in with some ladies that does different types of basket, and they put me under their wing, and they had me going all different places and sitting in the mattress with sweetgrass basket. Some people didn't like it, because they talk about you shouldn't do this and you shouldn't. I said, well, when God give you a talent, you supposed to share that talent, regardless of what. You can't just stop doing things just because other people tell you not to do it. I said, well, the day when you tell me that you can do it, I'm going to do it even more. Because they used to be mad with me, and I said, no, you can't. I said, no. I said, when you sell your basket and people ask you questions about your basket, and if you don't want to give a little history or something on your basket, why are you making the basket? Because it's history. You're supposed to pass the word on. I went to school in Mount Pleasant. I went to Jeannie Moore Elementary School, and it was like an all-black school. And we went to first to sixth grade. Yeah, and when we graduated, we went to Lang. Lang, it used to be Lang High School, and then they segregated us, and we had to go to Moultrie. So I graduated from Moultrie High School in Mount Pleasant. That went my last year in high school. But we didn't want to go to leave our high school to go to school, because they made our high school into a middle school. But we didn't like it. But we finished school, and I took goodness courses. And I like to do business classes, bookkeeping and stuff. But that's how a school. Yeah. I never get a chance to go to college because my mom couldn't afford college. So I just learn on hand-on-hand clothes. And I'll take that back because when my brothers and sisters there went to college, I learned right along with them because I did more paper. I did more papers and what they did in college than they get the grade. Yeah, but I helped them right along in school, which I wasn't there. During my early age, my grandmama used to can vegetables. And they used to can okra. We used to have to cut up all these okras and snap these beans and then they get the mason jar and they wash it and then they have to put the cangas in there and let it boil, lance and boil and cook in a big old wash tub over open fire. Then they put it up. And then they share with the neighbors, talk about, oh, I got these jar of this and jar of pea and all this. They give, they share all this stuff. Even with meat and stuff, they share. They kill a hog, they share. And then we'll plant corn and lima bean and okra, sweet potato, green peanut. Then at that time, we had to harvest all our stuff and make sure everything is up for the winter. And like when, just like when I start cooking, I love to cook. I love to cook.
So you've got that?
Down. I love cooking for my grandmama. My first dinner I had fixed, I had to stay home from school one day. And she told me, she said, come on, I can show you how to cook. I cook beef stew. And like, you know, when the short rib, okay. And she showed me that and I've been cooking ever since. I like to cook. Everybody, I've been a cafeteria worker for 28 years and I love that job. I do catering, I do cooking for the church, and I just like to feed people. I like to bake chicken. I love to bake chicken.
Okay.
And like and then with the vegetable and the soup. I like fixing cabbage and collard greens and, oh, it's so much. I just like to cook all over macaroni and my favorite thing is probably is my red rice because everybody usually asks me how to fix half the. I make different styles of rice. They always like, they have a little catering or a party type of, Miss Barbara, can you make me a pan of brown rice or red rice or whatever? They love the red rice and I like doing that. And I like to bake, I like to make sweet potato pie. That's my favorite thing to make, sweet potato pie and cornbread. I always tell people, you, when you cook, if you don't cook with love, it doesn't taste good. Mm-mm. Cause this pastor always said, Bobby, y'all cook. I don't never see y'all make nothing. It tastes good. I said, all you have to do is put in your pot a four-letter word. And she said, what that is? I said, L-O-V. If you love to cook, you love to eat, and it tastes good. Really, it doesn't taste good to you. It tastes good to me. Yeah, but when I cook, I don't even taste my food. I don't want to say like, you know, like, just say you ain't got enough salt or whatever. It's just a feel, this, that, you know, I can shake a couple. Oh, no, that ain't too much salt. I said, don't worry about that. Taste it. You shake it. You have to shake it and season it with a touch, and everything will be all right. When you got a family, your family come first. And when you do all you can do for your family, and when, I always believe that when you got children, don't spoil your children. You can give them enough just to satisfy them now, but if you give them too much, you hurting them. Because when they get too much, they don't know how to go out and get for you, for themselves. Because if you keep on giving them over and over, they can't know how to, you know, provide for themselves. That I really believe that in my, you know, because my kids, I give them just enough, but I'm not going to spoil them. Just like my kids are saying, well, mommy ain't gonna buy me that shoe. I said, no, I ain't gonna buy you that shoe. When I said, no, that shoe is too expensive, you could put it in some corner, no. But when they started working, they knew exactly where I was coming from. When my daughter, this one, she first started working, and she got her little check, you know, going to the store. I said, go ahead and pay for your stuff. She paid for it. She said, man, she take all my money. I said, that's the same way. You take my money to pay for that. And then she said, oh, yeah. Mm-mm. From then on, she lay a dead man die on a penny again. Because she had scratched that dollar all the way. But they come. And they believe in working. She been working since she been 14. My other daughter been working since she been like 15 or 16. My other son, she been working like 15 or 16. All of them started out, and all of them is successful because I do not spoil them. I tell them, y'all need to get out just like how I got out. And I back them. Just like when they go to college, when they went to college, you know, I was there. I didn't give them no unnecessary money for them to blow. I tell them, I said, I'm working to help y'all out. But they understand exactly where I was coming from, and they appreciate that to the day. But I don't, just like with my grand, I got three grand, well, four. The little one is just starting out. I do the same thing with them. I'm not spoiling you. When you let them kids run to you for everything, all they'll do is don't learn the value of nothing. Where you need to learn how I got this money to spend for you so that you can see when you get older how I had to work for my money. But that's how I do with them. And another thing is that you need to go to church and get close to God, because some people think that you don't do nothing without God. They think God is just like on standby. They just want to call him when they're in bad trouble or need. But if you put God in the picture all the time, the picture is gonna be so pretty and so clear. But you can't do that without God. You gotta get yourself close to God and learn that you got to depend on Him right now. God give you the give you a lesson, and if you said you follow your lesson and your plan, you would say, "Nah, I know I ain't did this," and you know, things goes on and you don't know how it happened,
right?
Because you just thinking of it, and then you say, "I no." But if you had God and God going to work it out for you, you'd be so surprised. With these baskets, got a lot of history behind it. But when they was during the slavery time, these baskets was used for so many things and help people with so many things, because when they came over with the slave, basket was like something that they carry the clothes and stuff in and all of that. But as time went on, the basket got so popular, because when the slave owners them understand what they were making and what they were making it for, it was a mess, because the basket was made so strong and durable that they'd use it to make profit off it. Some slave owners used to let the men them sew the basket and take the money and just give them a little something for them. But the basket is, then as time went on, the basket start going into the houses. The ladies start making basket for use on the dining table, decorate the walls, and use it for serving platters and stuff. And as time went on, the baskets start traveling from state to state and giving gift to real popular people and princess and queens and stuff. Even the presidents, them got basket all over the place. But these basket is, when they see us making these basket, it just like a light up on their face. They "Oh, how you do that? How you can just get that little weed and make a beautiful basket?" And the basket is made, some of these ladies make, oh God, I don't know how God give them the gift to make some basket. They just make it like, you know, I don't even know how they do it. But the thing about it, when you making a basket, it's not for you. Like, if you got a basket, you making a basket, it's for you. God give you that vision to put that basket together. But some people are trying to make it, but it's not gonna make like how you made it. Everybody got a vision to make baskets. I don't make too much of fancy, but I like tradition basket. Basket that you can put in the house and serve for brews. Make a flower basket or a bouquet or Easter basket or something like that. I don't do all these parlor fancy basket. And some ladies just got the art to put fancy basket that is on display. They make real nice big. I look at the basket and I'm amazed. I say, "How the devil they put that together?" I didn't know how they do that. Then some of them would say, "But Barbara, can you make?" Nope. I can't do that. No, not all that twisting and turning. Right now, I've been trying to make a basket It's a simple basket, but I do not know how they put the middle in the side of it. So I stopped. That ain't for me. So I don't do that. But, you know, when I go to the different shows and stuff, they just like amazed. They said, how you do that? And then when I be teaching the class, she said, Barbara, those baskets, I ain't gonna tell nobody that I'm gonna make another one because it is hard and contagious work. But the thing about it is like in the mind, you gotta let it go with your hand. But if you don't know how to work your hand, you ain't gonna work no basket. But some ladies did, you know, go every time I go to the show, they always take a class. And then they always try to make something different. They go over, round and round. But the basket, they just like to just sit and watch you make basket all day. Just sit and just look at you. But some of the ladies, them don't like you to watch them. They say, well, if you buy a basket, I'll let you take a picture. No. You have to buy a basket from me. I'll take a picture in a heartbeat. So that's just like letting you know that you can take a picture without buying a basket from him. That's just sending the matches out saying that, oh, hey, this lady makes sweetgrass basket. This is nice or whatever. And I get basket and pull it up like they purchase it and didn't even buy it. They just, you know, want to take a picture with the basket. And sometimes my phone rang and stuff. Barbara, you remember the basket? So-and-so, can you send that basket to me? I put it in the mail and send it right on. God always giving you the picture and they don't even know it. I know everybody for themselves. They don't have that bond when I was saying like with my grandmother and stuff, because now with the sweetgrass basket, like when we used to go harvest material, and if you sick and we go pull sweetgrass, they can say, oh, so and so, let's pull a little bundle of grass and carry over to Aunt Sue's house and thing, but they don't do that no more. They have lost looking out for the other basket weavers, because all they want to do is take in for themselves and they don't think about nobody else. But just like when they harvest their stuff, they'll get everything and they don't think, even they'll say, well, you got a bundle of grass that I can get. No, I ain't got no grass. And they got a whole heap of grass. But they're done change from that. It's not helpful to help each other no more. And they always try to stop other basket weaver to get ahead when they wanna do. If they got a show and need somebody else for a show, instead of they say, well, so and so, I can get so and so to do. No, they wanna try to do all of them. Some of them would say they'll get their basket and split it and go to this show and go to that show. Instead of, no, you go ahead and take that one of them. But they're not sharing like they're supposed to. They're not doing that at all. They are getting too far away from the tradition and not caring for each other.